ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Jenny, for that introduction. Very well captured. I am greatly honored to be with you this afternoon to present to you the status of biotechnology in Kenya. But even before I do that, I'd like to introduce a team of other Kenyans that we are visiting with, who are members of the National Biosafety Authority. We are here for a study tour to see how Philippines is handling biosafety and biotechnology issues, and see what we can borrow from you. And as we develop our own biosafety regulatory framework. So I'd like to introduce Professor Miriam Kenyua. Professor Miriam Kenyua is the chair of the National Biosafety Authority Board. She is a prominent scientist in plant breeding and biotechnology, and also a teacher at the University of Moi in Eldoret. Next, I would like to introduce Professor Moses Limo. Professor Limo is a professor of molecular biology and biotechnology at Egerton University in Kenya, and also a member of the National Biosafety Authority Board. He chairs the technical committee of the National Biosafety Authority. Next, I'd like to introduce Mr. Otula Owol. Journalist, a science journalist, a member of the National Biosafety Authority Board. He brings in expertise in communicating biotechnology and communicating science into the National Biosafety Authority. And finally, I'd like to introduce Cecilia Nzau. Cecilia Nzau is my colleague at the National Biosafety Authority. She is an environmental scientist, but largely she's handling administrative matters within the National Biosafety Authority. She has a long experience in civil service. She has served in public service for a number of years. So thank you very much and welcome. Once more, I'm honored to be here. Like you have heard, I studied in China, and therefore this side of the world is not very new to me. I can very easily use the chopsticks, the kwaise in Chinese. And therefore, thank you. So I'm just going to give you an overview of the policy, legal, and regulatory framework, including the administrative structures that are in place in Kenya to address biosafety in biotechnology. Largely, the biosafety authority in Kenya is in its formative stages. It's setting up, we're starting up, and that is why we came over here, because you have a longer history, so that we can learn from you. Basically, therefore, a functional biosafety regulatory framework has about four components. There is the policy, which spells out a government's agenda in the area of biosafety. There is the legal and the regulatory framework, the laws that govern the practice of biosafety and biotechnology. And then there is the administrative mechanism, an institution like the National Biosafety Authority, which handles the administrative aspects of governing biotechnology. And finally, a mechanism to provide public participation, so that as activities involving GMO go out there, there is a mechanism to talk to the people down, and the people also to talk back to the scientists and to the product developers. In this regard, I will go through the aspects of the Kenyan components in these four areas. Regarding policy, Kenya published a National Biotechnology Development Policy in 2006. And those of us who were in Nagoya, Japan during the negotiations where we met Dr. Ray, will recall the leader of our delegation, the then Minister for Science and Technology, Honorable William Ruto's statement at the opening of the COPMO meeting in Nagoya, where he said, "Let those with the luxury to choose whether to have red meat, white meat, or whatever other color meat, not stand on the way of those who are simply asking for a meal. This was a strong statement coming from the leader of government delegation to that top level negotiations. In short, therefore, he's saying, if you can choose to have the organics or the non-organics, let the choice be left to those who can make a choice. But let the world allow us to develop technologies that address our needs as a people. The National Biotechnology Development Policy of Kenya has key statements that tell the aspiration of the Kenyan government the where we want to go. And these were done way back in 2006. For example, the government recognized the role biotechnology can play in poverty reduction, enhancing food security, and in the conservation of biodiversity and the environment. This is a recognition that it's clear that biotechnology can play a role in addressing some of these challenges. And the government of Kenya recognized that way back in 2006. Next, the responsibility of every government is to safeguard its citizens and the environment against any development or introduction of deleterious organisms in whatever form. So once more again, the government recognizes that there is need to protect the environment. There is need to protect the citizens from organisms that could cause negative impact to the environment and the health of humans. And then the policy promises that this policy will provide those developing and applying the technology a clear framework in which to operate in order to address fears on their safety. So in this regard, therefore, it is recognized that biotechnology can provide solutions. It is also recognized that there is need for government to protect its citizens and also the environment from organisms that could cause negative impact on the health of humans and also the environment. Finally, the policy will provide a framework upon which developers of this technology, users of this technology, can operate and can address the fears, because fears have been spread in many ways, including the lobby groups that go around spreading untruths. Some other policy statements arising again from the same policy document: the government will ensure risk assessment and management is done on all introduced genetically modified material, while legislation will be developed to govern and safeguard the use and development of biotechnology products. Again, this is a commitment that risk assessments will be carried out on all GMOs introduced into the country, and that with a view to safeguard the use of biotechnology products. So again, it's a commitment by government. And finally, the government will, as a matter of priority, initiate steps to explore the use of biotechnology for the benefit of Kenyans and ensure that Kenya becomes a key participant in the international biotechnology enterprise. The business community, the business aspect of biotechnology is growing every day. From figures that we have seen in increasing acreage of farms that are growing GM crops, it is evident that the business space is increasing in this technology. And therefore, the government recognizes that Kenya has got to participate in this enterprise, in the biotechnology enterprise. Next is the legal and the regulatory framework. After the enactment, the coming into force of the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety, we embarked into developing a policy and then a law that will address biosafety in modern biotechnology. In this regard, the country enacted the Biosafety Act in 2009. A difference from what happens here in Malaysia, in Philippines, where you have many departments that handle various aspects of biosafety in biotechnology using existing legislation, Kenya chose to go the full way of creating a whole new set of legislation to address biosafety in biotechnology. And this brought out the Biosafety Act, which was enacted in 2009. The key thrust of this act is to establish the National Biosafety Authority, the NBA. And the purpose for which the authority was established is to exercise general supervision and control over the transfer, handling, and use of genetically modified organisms with a view to ensure safety of human health and provision of an adequate protection of the environment. So this is our mandate as an authority to control and govern the use and transfer of genetically modified organisms. Again, this is borrowing heavily from the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety, which Kenya was the first country to sign the protocol. And therefore, we're picking from that, and we have gone to do a complete set of legislation for this purpose. The next step, we have drafted the biosafety regulations, regulations that accompany the act. Generally, the law provides the generalities, the way this law will be done, this will be applied like this, but the regulations now specify what one needs to do to apply for contained use, for environmental release, general release in the environment, and for import, export, and transit of genetically modified organisms. These drafts are, we have taken through them through a stakeholder analysis. They are now undergoing some legal scrutiny within our state law office, and very soon they are going to be published. This will pave the way to get material that has been in confined field trials out of confinement into commercial or environmental release. Before the Biosafety Act was put in place, there was the National Biosafety Committee, which was established under the National Council for Science and Technology, using an existing law, the Science and Technology Act, CAP 250 of 1979. This committee, the National Biosafety Committee, was the one that used to evaluate applications for GMOs and issue permits or approvals to carry out genetic modified activities, basically for research, in contained use and confined field trials. Now, next, so after that, then the National Biosafety Authority was established, and this led to the establishment of the National Biosafety Authority Board, which was inaugurated in 2010. This is the board where Professor Miriam chairs, and where we have members that are present with us today. And the National Biosafety Authority is the competent authority of the government of Kenya on matters of biosafety in biotechnology. And it is also the focal point for the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety, and also the focal point for the Biosafety Clearing House, also under the Cartagena Protocol on biosafety. The NBA, National Biosafety Authority, doesn't work alone. We operate with regulatory agencies. This is now where it becomes a little more similar with what is here in the Philippines. We work together with the Kenya Plant Health Inspectorate Service, KEPHIS. This could be the equivalent of the Bureau for Plant Industry here in Philippines. Then we also work with the National Environmental Management Authority. And again, here probably this can be equated to the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. And also, the other regulatory agency and our NBA is the Kenya Bureau of Standards. This one sets standards for food safety, for packaging, for labeling, and for transit, using based on the Codex Alimentarius system. Then we also work with the Directorate of Public Health to look on the health issues of food safety related to products of genetically modified organisms. Then the Directorate of Veterinary Services to address issues of veterinary science, animal biotechnology. the Kenya Industrial Property Institute to address the issues of property rights, who owns the particular technology we are talking about, either being imported or being developed. Then the Kenya Wildlife Service. Kenya is recognized as one of the mega diverse countries, and our Kenya Wildlife Service is an important integral part of our economy, and therefore KWS is also part of our regulatory agencies. And finally, the National Council for Science and Technology to interrogate the science behind the technology that is being developed. We also work with the Ministry of Agriculture, which like you can imagine, the greatest area of application of GMOs is in crop science and crop production. So that is therefore the administrative mechanism, the National Biosafety Authority plus the regulatory agencies. One of the key things that comes up is issues of coordination. How do we ensure that this system works? It also comes up, I'm sure, within the Philippine system, and we are continuously working on a coordination structure that will clearly establish the roles of all these regulatory agencies and to ensure that there is harmony in the way they perform their respective mandates. Public participation. We engage stakeholders in workshops. We just concluded a stakeholders workshop on COMESA draft policies on guidelines. COMESA is a regional trading bloc that has 19 member countries within the East and Southern Africa region. So this is a huge trading bloc, and the agenda is to try to harmonize our guidelines and policies to facilitate trade within our bloc and with other outside blocs in products of biotechnology. Then we have taken stakeholders through the draft biosafety regulations. Actually, this took place on April 12th, and we have incorporated the comments from the stakeholders. The regulations are on their way to be published. Within the Ministry of Agriculture, there is a program called BioAware. This is an awareness creating program which has a mandate to go out and create awareness on biosafety and biotechnology. Because one of the key challenges is level of awareness. I'm sure it is experienced everywhere, including even in the Philippines. People are not aware what is this biotechnology, what is this GMO, why do we have to do GMO if we can use conventional breeding technology, and so many other questions of the low levels of awareness. And this is where the anti-biotechnology, anti-GM groups have come in to exploit the weakness of low levels of awareness to develop fear in our population, and it is a big problem. Then we have outreach and sensitization programs, some that are run by the University of Nairobi and ISA, the International Service on the Acquisition of Agribiotech Applications. There is a task force now that is working to see how to move the cotton from confinement. We have cotton, BT cotton, undergoing confined field trials to see how to move it from the confined field trials to commercialization. And this task force is also carrying out awareness and outreach programs. Then the Africa Harvest is an NGO also in Kenya, which is conducting a lot of outreach programs. There are many others. So in effect, therefore, the biosafety framework in Kenya is complete. We have a policy, we have a legal framework, we have an administrative mechanism, and we have a mechanism for public participation. And although it is still in its nascent stages. Currently, we do not have any commercial release of GM crops or product in Kenya. This could happen anytime now after we have published the regulations. Otherwise, at the moment, we only have confined field trials and laboratory-based kind of contained activities on transformations. Some of the activities that are going on within the country, we have a number of confined field trials. BT cotton has been going on for some time. We just concluded insect resistant maize. This is maize that can resist the corn borer, the African corn borer. Here you have the Asian corn borer. So it is the equivalent of that. Then water efficient maize, maize that can efficiently utilize water and therefore be able to withstand drought. Very, very important because much of our country is water deficit. Sweet potato virus resistant. Resistance to the sweet potato feathery motor virus. These confined field trials were concluded. The data is still undergoing analysis and other kind of processing. Then within cassava, we have a confined field trial for virus resistance, which is taking place in the western part of the country. And also for cassava, a confined field trials for biofortified cassava. Cassava that is fortified to provide nutrients, higher levels of nutrients. And then also concluded was a confined field trial for rinderpest vaccine for cattle. So this is quite unique within the animal system. So those are the confined field trials. The pictures you see, this is a CFT at a place called Alupe in Kenya, conducted by the Kenya Agriculture Research Institute. And basically this is a cassava CFT site. This is the entrance. This is just a small shelter for the person who takes care of the CFT. And this is another CFT site at Kiboko, also for water efficient maize. And also it was the same site where the insect resistant maize for Africa program was conducted. Again, this is the entrance and some you can see the fencing and so on. The other activities involve lab transformations in cassava for post-harvest deterioration. Cassava that can withstand longer periods of storage without developing soft spots and getting spoiled in storage. Then we have banana for wilt resistance. And then pigeon pea for insect resistance, and yam for nematode resistance. All these are taking place within the International Livestock Research Institute, ILRI, in Nairobi. And they are basically transformation, laboratory-based transformations for onward movement to other stages. Again, the picture here shows part of Kiboko, the site for maize transformation, and particularly I picked this because of the trench that has been dug here to take care of wild animals. The CFT happened to take place at a place where occasionally there would be elephants migrating from one side of a park to another, and they constantly used to destroy the fence. And one solution was found was to make a trench around the CFT. Later on, the fence was fortified with electric fence, a fence that when the animal approaches, can go back. So, because Kenya is a wildlife country, this is, I think, the season when wildebeests are crossing the Mara. I think it is the eighth wonder of the world, I'm not sure. You're welcome to visit and see the elephants in the sea. Further, we have a number of activities that have been, applications have been forwarded to the NBA for consideration, and these are under review. Sorghum for biofortification, biofortified sorghum that can express a number of nutrients and that can reduce the effects of phytate, which is an anti-metabolite, which reduces uptake of iron and other nutrients from sorghum. Then we have another application that we're considering called the knockout mice. This is the importation of mice that can be used to study the effect of taking away certain genes or making certain genes not to express, and also an application to try proof of concept for trypanosome resistance in cattle. So some, these are some of those that are still coming in and that are undergoing review within our bureau. Expected commercial releases. In the near future, we expect to have BT Cotton. I think that is the one that is closest. In my own opinion, there is a lot of experience now with BT Cotton from all over the world. And we have also had a lot of experience from our own CFTs. And as soon as the regulations are published, especially the environmental release regulations, we should be able to move this cotton now out of confinement to farm fields. The other one is for import and transit of emergency food. Kenya is a corridor through which many other African countries pass their food, especially for aid or food for importation. Uganda, DRC, Congo, Sudan, all these countries depend on the port of Mombasa in Kenya for passage of their products. So we expect therefore that many applications will be coming asking for authorization to transit or even to supply the same to Kenya. We also expect applications to come in for importation of food, feed and seed for placing in the market. That is why we have come to observe your system and find out what are some of the things we can borrow from this end to assist us in moving this forward. Opportunities. What opportunities are there for us as NBA and as a country? Number one, we have a lot of support from the ministry, from the policy makers. The environment is good, right from parliament, from our parent ministry, which is the Ministry of Higher Education, Science and Technology, and from other relevant ministries like the Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Environment, we have support. Number two, we have sufficient budgetary allocation by government. We have not been complaining. As an authority, the government has allocated to us enough funds to be able to run our functions. Number three, partnerships for capacity building. For example, we are here out of a partnership with PBS, the Program for Biosafety Systems. And we look forward to further partnerships with the African Biotechnology Network of Expertise, APNI, with this, the university here, the University of Philippines, Los Banos, the Biotech Center here. We look forward to have collaborative initiatives that can spur partnership between ourselves and this institution. Professor Miriam Kenyo, like I say, is a professor of plant biotechnology and plant breeding, and therefore this university can pair up. Again, Professor Limo is also a professor in the university. So there is a lot of potential in this area, and we look forward to really engage in a close interaction with established institutions here. Number four, we have sufficient technical capacity at the MBA. The board as what it requires, what is required to run a functional biosafety and biotechnology institution. Like I have just mentioned, two and a few others that are here, they are people with the relevant qualifications and the expertise that is sufficient to run the MBA. Number five, next, is that we have suppressed and biotech activities. We have been reading about the story of Bridges in Philippines. And today we got, this week, this has been shared with us over the week. Bridges are the eggplants. I think that is what you call them here. Where some people came into a confined field trials and destroyed the field trials. And some others obtained orders to stop the activity. These people are all over because they have an agenda. But in Kenya at the moment, their tempo has gone down. But that may not last long because they usually wait until when you're about to commercialize a product, then it comes up. In Philippines as well, I think they had gone down. Until then, there was some indicators that the eggplant is almost getting to the outside the confinement. Then the activity came up again. So we are fortunate, at least now, the activity within the country is reasonably suppressed. Next is staff development. We are in the process of recruiting staff for the MBA, and therefore we have opportunity again to bring in competent staff that are full-time serving the National Biosafety Authority. Like I say, the National Biosafety Authority is still in its formative stages. We are putting it together. Myself and my colleague Cecilia, we are working there also under the ministry. We have been sent to the authority from the ministry, and therefore we have a chance to upgrade the institution. Then the regional approaches to harmonize the biosafety policies and guidelines. These are opportunities that can make guidelines and policies be harmonized to enhance trade within the COMESA region, the common market for Eastern and Southern Africa, and the RABESA initiative. This is a program of COMESA, mandated by COMESA to try to harmonize policies within this, that region to enhance the participation of our countries in trade within ourselves and outside the outside world. Finally, I'd like to share this photograph. This was taken in Michigan State University in one of the fields. This is Genuity Smart Tanks. This corn has 8 genes, 8 transgenes, some stacked, others pyramided for glyphosate tolerance or resistance, and for the cry genes for various kind of insects resistance. So if we the scientists are already here, there is no reason why we should not get these products again to get to the farmer fields, the stacked genes that can address issues of water salinity, drought resistance, and insect resistance at the same time. So the scientists are already quite ahead in terms of developing this technology, and therefore we shouldn't be still at that stage where we are asking whether BT cotton or not BT cotton. We need to move this technology forward. I'd like to thank the Program for Biosafety System for facilitating our travel here, and in this regard I wish to recognize the presence of Karen Hawkinson from the PBS. Karen joined our team. In fact, we are introducing her as one of the Kenyan delegates coming to the Philippines. We shall give her a passport when we get back to Nairobi. And also for PBS again, Dr. Ray and Carl, this visit for us. Otherwise, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Roy, for sharing the biotechnology and biosafety updates and opportunities in Kenya. Before we proceed with the open forum, let me, for the interest of all the delegates from Kenya, let me inform you of the composition of the audience. So we have scientists and researchers here from the International Rice Research Institute, or IRI. We also have scientists from UPLB. Some of them are also working on research efforts which are also related to the current initiatives in Kenya. We also have regulators from ERDB and also from UPLB Institutional Biosafety Committee. Of course, we also have participants from Biotech, UPLB Biotech, headed by Dr. Ray Ibora, and of course some UPLB students. And of course, from CIRCA, and headed by our CIRCA director, Dr. Hilsa Gigit, sir. So now we're open with the questions. Who want to ask the first question for Dr. Roy Mugira? May we request you to introduce yourself and your agency for proper documentation. Ma'am Lolly Dolores.
I'm Lolly Dolores from the Institute of Plant Breeding. I'm also working on GM sweet potato. But my question is, you indicated in your slides that before you have your bicepti permit approved, you have to undergo different regulatory agencies, right? So you have the National Biosafety and different regulatory agencies, I think eight agencies were indicated. I'm just wondering, or I'm just curious whether how long will your permit be approved if it will pass through each agency?
Thank you, Dr. Lorenz. The eight agencies are not linear in their operation. So you will not be required to go to Science and Technology Council, to Plant Health. They are represented in our board as board members. So within the technical committee of the board, there is a representative from each of these regulatory agencies. So your application will be considered once, in one sitting of the technical committee. Then if it is in plant area, we will give you a permit. For example, if your application is successful, we allow the research institute to go on with the research and to liaise with the Kenya Plant Health Inspectorate Service for purposes of regular inspections and also for purposes of giving import permit if there is something you have to bring from outside for basically phytosanitary and other kind of inspect to fulfill other kind of laws. But basically the application is taken months.
So normally, how long will it take?
What is our experience? We have an experience. The most recent was on water efficient maize, the drought tolerant maize. We took about 60 days. At some point, we needed information from the applicant, so we don't count those days. You know, we stop to request the applicant to give us more information, so we stop the clock. It took about 60 days.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Professor can support Professor Miriam, please.
I guess I can be happy. The everybody. Within our law, it should take between 90 and 150 days. So even what Roy is saying, that when we finished at 60 days, we couldn't give the authority letter until 90 days, because 90 days, so you still need the money.
Okay, so I was responding that within the law, it should be between, we should have given the authority either a negative, I mean, we should give either a positive authority to do the research or a denial, depending on what information they've given us, between 90 and 150 days. So even when we finished at 60 days, we still had to wait to be within the law, and we gave them the permit on the 91st day.
Okay, Dr. Dolores said that it's very fast. Maybe in Philippines it takes, for experience it takes how many days? 1 year. Anyway, we should maybe we should emulate the Kenyan regulation. More questions? Any other questions from the audience? I have a question, Dr. Dr. Roy. You mentioned that the government is in full support in terms of funding for MBA, but how about in terms of research in GM CAS, for instance? Is your government also supporting you to do and fund public sector researches on GM?
Thank you, Jen. The support by government in research is general. It's not specifically on biotechnology or any other technology. However, there is a deliberate effort by government to within the science, technology, and innovation policy to flag out biotechnology as a flagship program. Within government planning, currently the blueprint we have in Kenya is Vision 2030, where we envision Kenya becoming a newly industrialized nation, middle economy country. After that vision, which is a long-term vision, the government, our ministry actually, Ministry of Higher Education, Science and Technology, has developed a policy that flags out, I don't know how to explain, a flagship. A flagship is something that carries your colors everywhere. It has picked biotechnology as a flagship project, which means that it is being targeted as a project and as a technology that is considered in government as priority in terms of bringing around economic transformation, in addressing issues of food security, and so on. In the same way, as the government recognizes ICT, you know, information communication technology is also flagged as a flagship program. So the general funding, we are struggling to get to 1% GDP, which is a commitment by United Nations fraternity. Statistics are neither very clear, but a project that Madame Cecilia is working on has shown that our investment in science and technology in Kenya is now hitting about 0.66% of the GDP. This takes into account salaries for researchers, support for institutions like universities and Kenya Agriculture Research. So we are at 0.66%, which we think we're doing well in terms of supporting technology. So biotech is supported. His Excellency the President officiated the opening of the Kenya Agriculture Research Biosafety Level 2 screen houses. So it is really getting even the political support from very high quarters and assuring the population that you are in safe hands. You are in the hands of learned professors like the ones seated among us today, and the government is responsible enough to ensure that this technology works for the people of Kenya. So in both financing and in both political pronouncements and political engagement, when we did the stakeholders workshop, the minister herself attended in person and she gave assurances that this will be accorded priority, because biotechnology is recognized as one of those few technologies, including nanotechnology, that can turn around the fortunes of our community.
Thank you very much for that information. So yes, sir. See, sir first.
Thank you for your very interesting discussion. I have a suggestion, not a question, but a suggestion. We have also technologies here in the Philippines developed and probably being now developed and probably to be developed in the future. So is it possible that in Kenya you accept in your university or universities some graduate students from the Philippines, and in here in the Philippines, we also accept graduate students or professor visitors here, so that we could exchange and help each other develop these technologies so that, well, probably it is better to work together rather than work separately. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that comment. Thank you very much, sir. This morning we met your Vice Chancellor, responsible for research and extension at the university, and already talking is going on for a possibility of an exchange program for graduate students, so that your graduate students can have some experience back in Kenya, our own students can cross over. If a few of you are willing, maybe we can go back with them tomorrow. Who is willing? So already, this is the talking has started, and we look forward for this kind of exchange program. Like I mentioned, I studied in China, and the experience was phenomenal. And I'm sure that a few of our own students, if they come here, in fact, with the area around here, they will have a really, really wonderful experience in this place. And also your own students, when they come to Nairobi and to Kenya. That is very, the workings are already taking place. And thank you for that suggestion and that comment.
Okay, thank you. Next question, ma'am, later, right? Dr. Exponde, ma'am, you have a question.
I'm Kirdi Exponde from Biotech and also a member of the UPLB Biosafety Committee. Dr. Roy, you mentioned that in Kenya you have suppressed antibiotic activities. May you share with us how your regulatory agencies are dealing with these antibiotic groups? Thank you.
Thank you very much. In fact, we haven't done any kind of analysis to find out the reasons why, but in casual observations, I think it is because of constant support pronouncement from top authorities, top government officials. When the Minister for Agriculture stands out to speak, she talks positive about biotechnology. When the President stands to speak, he also does the same. So I think this has shown the groups that here there is a very firm support from the entire level of authority in government, and therefore we have seen it isn't moving far. Otherwise, we haven't done much except ordinary awareness creation. Our population now is also getting really aware of what is good for them and what is not good for them, and that is what has lifted the level of awareness and therefore suppressed the activities of the ant group. However, their funding still is there. They are very well funded people, we know that. But at the moment, they are down because of those, mainly the pronouncement by people in authority that this is a technology not of the future, but of today. And this is the technology that can address some of our problems and challenges that we face that part of the world.
Thank you for that, Dr. Roy. Since Philippines has new administration, so maybe we're looking forward for those pronouncements from our top executives. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, Vera.
Good afternoon. I'm Veronica Sinohin from Ecosystems Research Development Bureau of the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. May I know, Dr. Roy, if you require environmental impact statement in the evaluation of your proposal? And also another question is, do you require biosafety guarantee fund? Biosafety guarantee fund.
I will ask to be supported there by our chair, Professor Miriam. Anything to throw on that, then I will attempt to explain in terms of environmental impact assessment, which is a mandate for the National Environmental Management Authority. Now, from the biosafety point of view, we expected to have an environmental risk assessment. So these are two distinct areas, but I only say that discussions are going on between National Biosafety Safety Authority and the Environmental Management Authority to address that need. Currently, we have only a requirement for risk assessment, not environmental risk assessment. About guarantee, nowhere in our law, but let me ask our chairperson to assist with that.
Yeah, about the environmental impact assessment, if it has already been done wherever the event has been approved and that place is similar to our place, we normally will adopt what report was produced. If not, we insist that the scientist who's carrying out the research has to partner with either one of the regulatory agents or some other expert to be able to carry that out. So there has to be an environmental impact assessment report accompanying the application approval. On the fund, it's something that we've been discussing. And one thing that has been appreciated is that if we make carrying out biotechnology research very expensive, it means that we've already locked out our local scientists. And therefore, because of appreciating this, what is being put in place is that if anybody causes any mess in relation to GMO work, they are the ones to sort it out. If you are a local scientist, the government, if you are doing it in good faith and some problem comes up, the government will take care of that. So that's how we've accommodated it as of now, and I see it going that way, even in future, that if you are a local scientist, you're covered by the government, and therefore you don't need to have any guarantee fund. And if you are an outsider, you take care of the problem, and therefore it's not the fund as such, it is the fact that you are going to take care of whatever problem that will come up. I hope I've responded satisfactorily.
Okay, thank you for that. Any other question from the audience? Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Roy. I am Rizaldo Gibayot, from the retired faculty of the Crop Protection Cluster. You mentioned about genetically modified banana against wheat, but I don't know whether you are talking about bacterial wheat or fusarium wheat, because here in the Philippines we have these two wheat diseases are very, very important. The moco disease of banana, and then the fusarium wheat, and they are afraid that if the race four of the fusarium wheat, I think they say that it's already here, and it could wipe out the banana industry in Mindanao. So I would like to know if you are referring to the fusarium wheat or the bacterial wheat.
Thank you. The application is a transformation for bacterial wheat.